Good morning. How are we this morning? All right, one person's good. Thank you. The rest of you are fair to average, I take it? Yeah? All right, stand and worship with us this morning.
Of the Lord this morning.
Woo! Woo! Woo!
All right. Well, anyway, my name is Avery, and I just want to welcome you all to United Evangelical Free Church. And for those of you watching online, thanks for tuning in with us. If you're at the end of your row, there is a handy dandy little clipboard there, and we would love it if you would sign in for us. And then we have a couple of announcements for you today. The first one is a huge thank you to all of our volunteers that made Easter weekend happen. We're so grateful to everyone that, you know, cooked for Good Friday, helped with our egg hunt, you know, served on Sunday. Thank you so much. Could not have done it without you. You mean a lot to us. And then our next two announcements. Oh, yeah, give a clap for the volunteers, yeah. All right, our next two announcements are for the youth, so pay attention. First one is there is no youth group tonight. Our youth pastor is on vacation, so nothing happening here tonight. And then the second one is next Sunday, We're starting a new youth equipping you class taught by Patrick, and it is called Things Jesus Never Said. So it's going to be great. 7th through 12th graders, pull up. It'll be great. My next announcement is for the women. We're going to do a women's brunch Saturday, April 29th. It's going to be here. And signups will be happening in the lobby. You can find Miss Karen Lentz. She'll get you all hooked up and get you all the details for that. Oh, okay. Next two are for City Fest. So the first thing is April 20th at New Horizon Christian Center or Christian Fellowship. They're going to do what's called like relational evangelism training. It's going to be this, like a little like get together with, his name is Jose Zayas, I think. He's a pastor, evangelist. He's going to be teaching this training course, and it'll basically teach you guys how to, you know, evangelize with the people around you. And it's going to be a great, you know, thing leading up to City Fest, and that's April 20th, 7 p.m. And if you want to sign up, you just scan that QR code. It's a free event. The QR code is also in the lobby in case you don't get it up here quick enough. So. And then I think we have a video.
There's a story being told throughout our nation that the church is no longer relevant, that religion is dead. But God tells a different story. When the church unites around Jesus to love the city, to share his hope, to make him known, he moves. Lives are changed. The story is rewritten. It starts right now as we come together as one body. To share the good news, as we actively pray for our friends, our family, our neighbors, our coworkers, as we share the hope of Jesus through City Fest. Together, let's help our region experience Jesus in a fresh way, through prayer, through service, through the clear proclamation of the gospel. It starts with you. We have the hope Greater Klamath needs. Let's not hold back. Start praying now for your friends, your family, those who don't yet know Jesus, and invite them to City Fest. It's time to share the good news throughout our area. It's time for City Fest.
So with that, like the video said, you know, prayer is an important aspect of all of this coming together. So when you guys came in, hopefully you would have gotten handed a little prayer card. If you didn't, they're in the back. We also have pencils in the back. And what we want you all to do is there's five little lines, and what you do is put the names of five people that, you know, you want to be praying for, your unsaved friends, family, you know, coworkers, like the video said. So we want to challenge you to use that as like a prayer reminder to, you know, write their names and be constantly, you know, praying for those people, you know, in the time leading up to City Fest. And then our last thing is our missionaries of the week. This week are Luke and Jessica Bury, and they're with Reach Global, actually on their way to Berlin soon, hopefully to serve and bring the gospel there. So would you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we just pray, you know, for Luke and Jessica. We pray that you would, you know, keep them safe as they're getting ready, you know, to travel over to Berlin. And we pray that you would help them, you know, get all their paperwork finalized, and that you would just work out the logistics, like, you know, finding a place to live. You know, that was one of their prayer requests. So we just pray that you would keep your hand over them and that you would also help them reach their goal. They're 95% funded right now, so we pray that you would just, you know, help them get that last little bit, you know, give them a miracle in that sense. And we just pray that you would bless them and that you would use them as vessels to, you know, bring your word and your hope and your salvation to the people in Berlin. We praise you and we thank you for all that you're going to be doing through them and with them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, I realized something kind of cool this morning. I don't know why it hasn't struck me before, but this is my 25th year of leading worship around. That's kind of crazy to think about. It makes me feel really old. I know I'm not, but it feels that way. But you know, it's interesting because from the first day that you start until, you know, today, all the way through, the goal has always been the same. And as a worship team, it's always our heart is just to open the throne room of God for you guys to worship, to come and be in the presence of God, to just enjoy the glory that is God. So as we sing this next song, Goodness of God, You know, it's been the number one song on CCLI for like a year now because people just connect with it so deeply. So we just want to give you an opportunity as we sing this song just to quiet your heart, come into the presence of God, just come to a point where you're ready, where the outside is blocked out, and where all that matters in here is Jesus. So. I love you, Lord, and your mercy never fails me. In all my days, I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, and I will sing of the goodness of God. Let's sing that again. I love you, Lord, and your mercy never fails me. In all my days, I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, well, I will sing of the goodness of God. In all my life, you faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I get, well, I will sing of the goodness of God. Well, I love your voice. You have led me through the fire in darkest night. You are close like no other. Well, I've known you as a father, and I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. In all my life, you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath and I get able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, well, I will sing of the goodness of God. Yeah, I will sing of the goodness of God. A new beginning, heaven's come to earth.
shouts of praise ring out. Let your voices praise ring out. And this is the day that the Lord has made. Kingdoms come and kingdoms go. You endure, you never fail. Pride can take the strongest down. From a humble heart comes peace. You are Emmanuel dwelling with us. You touch us with your perfect touch. And this is the sound. This is the sound of love. This is the sound of love. Oh, 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 oh. This is a call to a greater future. We know he's coming soon. This is the sound of a great. Ring out, all you bells of praise, ring out. Let your voices praise, ring out. This is the day that the Lord has made. Kingdoms come and kingdoms go. You endure, you never fail. And pride can take the strongest down. From a humble heart comes peace. You are Emmanuel dwelling with us. You touch us with your perfect touch. And this is the sound. This is the sound of love. Oh, this is the sound of love. Higher and higher we raise our arms to the greatest King. Forever your goodness grows, for all eternity we sing. And higher we raise our arms to the greatest King. Forever your goodness grows, for all eternity we sing. Kingdoms come and kingdoms go. Fail. Pride can take the strongest down. From a humble heart comes peace. You are Emmanuel dwelling with us. You touch us with your perfect touch. This is the sound. This is the sound of love. This is the sound of love.
Father, we come excited with anticipation, Father, because we know that you are capable of great things. God, we know that you have a heart for this congregation. You want to see us mobile, active, and working for you, Father. So we pray as we take our offerings this morning that they would be an act of worship to you. Father, that we would give generously because you have given so generously to us. We love you. Amen.
Jesus, my Redeemer, there is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom. my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ.
Stand with us as we sing.
The night is dark, but I am not forsaken.
Didn't want heaven without.
We just want to stay in this moment, God. Pray that you would come here, fill us, make us part of your presence this morning, God. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. In the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. Savior, I come to quiet my soul. Remember, redemption's here, where your love is still. For my ransom, with everything I once held. Celebrate the risen Lord, but it's just equally as important that the other 51 weeks a year we do the same thing, right? So as we sing this song, we just want to recapture a little bit of the Easter experience and not let it go, because we can't help but be thankful every single year, every single day that Jesus did what he did for us. So let that be our mission.
Savior, I come, quiet my soul, remember, redemption's here, when your blood is still. Lead me to the cross.
So there's a special for pulpit use only music stand there, and there's one sitting here. I figure I might as well use it. If I start singing my sermon, just wave your hands and I'll switch back. So last Sunday, John started a new sermon series for us. And does anybody remember the title of the sermon series? Seismic Shift. That was the easy question today. But as long as I'm asking questions, I wonder how many of you pay attention to what we sing about when we sing. And I wonder how many of you pay attention to sermons such that a few days later, a week later, a month later, something still sticks, or it's just sort of massage your brain Sunday morning and then it goes away. So as a teacher, I'm going to give you all a quiz. As I speak today, I want you to think about the things that we sang this morning. And when you make a connection, take the point this week sometime to send Patrick a thank you for being open to the Lord's leading in the songs that he picked out that fit so well with what the Lord laid on my heart. We didn't coordinate, so it must have been the Lord that coordinated. So as you recall those things, let Patrick know that you appreciate that. So the new sermon series, Seismic Shifts. And John got to go first, so he got to pick the easy one. And he actually talked about two shifts, a personal one, where he realized that throughout the Bible, everything's about Jesus. It's not just the Gospels, not even just the New Testament, but everything's about Jesus. So we talked about that. But the bigger one, he talked about an earthquake, you know, the earthquake that happened Easter morning, and all of a sudden the tomb was open, and the Son of God is no longer dead. Instead, death is dead. And because of that, everything has changed. That was the easy one. Unfortunately, often with seismic shifts, you get a lot of destruction. Buildings crash down and whatever. And the Easter morning earthquake, the only thing that broke open was Jesus's tomb. And we were also told that other tombs broke open and people came back from the dead and wandered around. And we're not told a lot about that, but that apparently happened. This morning, the thing that the Lord has laid on my heart is a seismic shift in my life that wasn't as glorious as Easter morning. Instead, it left some cracked walls and broken masonry and all of that kind of stuff. So I'm going to start with a story, and then I'll go back and show you, hopefully through the Lord, or through the Word, how the Lord is continuing to work in my life, in part in response to that seismic shift. So I think many of you know I teach at OIT. I finished my graduate work in winter quarter of 2012, so 11 years ago. And so then it became job search time, applying to teach in various universities. Had an interview at Southern Oregon University, just across the hill in Ashland. And Phil talked about withdrawing applications. I eventually pulled my application out of that one. Mary and I drove down and did the interview, and then on our way back, we actually stopped because I had a phone interview with another school, Gonzaga University in Spokane. Those of you that are college basketball fans, you know about Gonzaga because they typically do well. Got invited for an in-person interview, and so Mary and I made the drive up to Spokane. And we both really felt like the Lord was leading us to Spokane. There were just so many things that just seemed to line up, that's where God was leading us. And then I didn't get the job. And that was the earthquake moment in my life. But it really had little, if anything, to do with the fact that I didn't get the job. I think that would have been a good job. It would have been a very challenging one. The workload would have been higher than where I'm at now, but that was not the issue. And so that's the story. Now I want to lead you through what the real issue was, and where I hope the Lord is taking me from there. So can you go to the next slide? So I want you to turn in your Bibles to John chapter 10. That's where we're going to start. John chapter 10 is the shepherd chapter. A few weeks ago, Phil gave us a sermon on sheep, and I'm not going to repeat our inner sheepness. That's not my focus this morning. I'll just start in verse 1 of chapter 10. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who does not enter by the door into the fold of the sheep, but climbs up some other way, he is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is a shepherd of the sheep. And I don't have as much of a sheep background as Phil does, but my understanding is they would build an enclosure, and there would be a hole in the wall, a gap in the wall, and that was the door that the sheep could go in and out of. And someone would be the door. They would sleep there in the doorway so that, you know, whatever kind of animals they had or thieves, whatever, couldn't get in without tripping over him. And so that's the picture Jesus is painting here, that there's the enclosure, and if somebody climbs over the wall, well, they're clearly up to no good, a thief, a robber, wolves leaping over the wall, whatever it happens to be. But he who enters by the door is a shepherd of the sheep. And so my understanding from the way Jesus describes this is once you went through the trouble to build the enclosure, you might as well allow multiple flocks of sheep to spend the night in there. And then, you know, one person would be the doorway, and then in the morning the shepherds would come out back to get their sheep. And so, you know, he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him, the doorkeeper opens. And so you're a shepherd, come on in. But now you've got all these sheep milling around, and somehow I need to get my sheep out and leave everybody else's sheep there. And how do you do that? And it says here, to him the doorkeeper opens, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name, and he leads them out. When he puts forth all his own, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. And a stranger they simply will not follow, but will flee from him because they do not know the voice of strangers. This is what shook me. I thought the Lord was leading us to Spokane. And it's not that I heard voices, so to speak, but I was under the impression that the shepherd was leading us there. And the door closed. And so what on earth happened? Do I know my shepherd's voice? Or was I listening to something else? That's the thing that shook me. Do you know the Lord's voice? Can you tell the difference between when he's calling you versus you just have this idea that this ought to be the thing I ought to do? Because this says that the sheep know the voice of the shepherd. We've never had sheep. We did have a few cows for a while. And my neighbor, I borrowed his bull at breeding time so that our cows could have calves. And I noticed that he could call his bull and the bull would come to him. And I thought, that's kind of cool. Maybe I can teach my cows to do that. And so to train them when the pasture was all eaten down and so they were largely dependent on hay, I carried a pad of hay out into the field where they were and then I called them. And they saw, hey, he's got hay, let's come. And so they came. And I did that repeatedly farther and farther away. Eventually got to where they could be anywhere in the property and I would call them and they would come running. Not because they had any particular attachment to me, but because they wanted to get fed. But apparently sheep, they know the shepherd personally, and they know his voice, and they hear his voice. And even when they're milling about in the sheepfold with all their buddies from the other flocks, when their shepherd calls, they follow him out into the field because they recognize the voice of their shepherd. And so do you recognize the voice of your shepherd, and do I recognize the voice of the Lord Jesus? And through that incident, it really made me question whether I did or not. Couple of other verses in the same chapter, verse 14. I am the good shepherd, and I know my own, and I know my own, and my own know me. Even as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. So I know my own, and my own know me, Jesus said, in just the same way that I know the Father, and that the Father knows me. Are you as in tune to the voice of the Lord Jesus as Jesus was in tune with the voice of the Father? And am I as in tune to the voice of the Lord Jesus as Jesus is in tune with the Father? And again, through that Spokane incident, it sure seemed like my answer was no. Still in the same chapter, verse 22, some of the leaders said, you know, how long are you going to keep us in suspense? When are you going to tell us who you are? And Jesus said in verse 25, I told you, and you do not believe the works that I do in my Father's name. These bear witness of me. But you do not believe because you are not of my sheep. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And so again, making such a clear point that if we are to be his sheep, if we claim to be his sheep, do we know his voice? Can we distinguish his voice from all the other stuff that comes into our head? And Jesus seems to be saying that his sheep ought to be able to do that. I want you to turn now to Philippians chapter 3. Paul talks about knowing the Lord Jesus, and so I want to take a look at that as well. I'm not going to go through the whole chapter. There's a lot of great stuff in there, but not directly relevant to what I want to talk about. Finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things again is no trouble to me and a safeguard for you. Hopefully everybody who comes and shares the pulpit up here has that view and the things that we're saying, that certainly no trouble for me to speak this stuff. I delight doing it, and I hope it's a safeguard and a benefit to you. Beware of the dogs, beware of the evil workers, beware of the false circumcision, for we are the true circumcision who worship in the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. I'd love to expound on that, but that's not what I wanted to focus on. But thinking about put no confidence in the flesh, and then Paul goes on and says, although I myself might have confidence in the flesh, if anyone else has a mind to put confidence in the flesh, I far more. And then the next couple of verses, he gives his resume, if you will, his pedigree, if you want to think of it that way, for all of the reasons why if anybody could put confidence in the flesh, certainly Paul could. Circumcised the eighth day of the nation of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to the righteousness which is in the law, found blameless. And so he was a rising star in Judaism. Not going to go through everything there, but you probably know of people who claim to be Christians but aren't actively following the Lord. Nominal Christians is a term we use for that. And other religions as well. Paul was certainly not a nominal Jew. How zealous was he for following God? He was so zealous that he got permission to go from town to town to round up the heretics who were profaning the name of God, round them up and kill them. Of course, he was a little bit misled because the people that he called heretics at the time, we call Christians. But that's how zealous he was. He was so zealous, he was willing to round people up that he thought were violating God's law to have them killed. And as to the law, he said, found blameless. If he was put on trial for having violated the law and it went to court, there would not be evidence to convict him. And yet, I don't think he's claiming to be perfect at this point in his life. He knew about the inward sins that weren't visible on the outside. But in terms of within Judaism, found blameless. So a rising star in Judaism, and as he thinks about it, his evaluation in verse 7, but whatever things were gained to me, all of the stuff that I had before as a rising star in Judaism, whatever things were gained to me, those things I have counted as loss for the sake of Christ. So he didn't merely say, you know, that stuff before, it's no big deal, I don't care about that anymore. He said that stuff that was a big deal to me, it's a negative in my life. It's a loss. It goes in the red ink column, not the black ink column. It was a loss. But then he goes farther. More than that, I count all things to be loss In view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them but rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ. What are the things in your life that when you compare them to knowing the Lord Jesus, you go, that other thing is absolutely garbage? You think of the balance scale. You put knowing the Lord Jesus on one side and everything else you put a value on the other side. How do they balance out? In Paul's mind, it didn't matter what was on that side. The value of knowing Christ Jesus as Lord was so great that all that other stuff is the garbage that we put out in our street and have hauled away week by week. At least we get weekly garbage service, except when it snows. So what are the things in your life? All things, he said, are garbage. So what about your family? What about your husband or wife, your kids, your grandkids? Jesus said, unless you hate those comparison with how much you love me, it's not good enough. What about your house, your home, where you live, quiet neighborhood, or living out in the country, or neighbors that you enjoy? What about your retirement benefits or whatever? What are the things that we hold on to that we say, you know, Lord, I really love you, but please don't take that away? Paul had nothing on that list. More than that, I count all things to be loss in view of the incredibly surpassing, amazing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them but rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and may be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own derived from the law, the confidence in the flesh that he started the chapter with, and may be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own derived from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which comes from God on the basis of faith. He didn't want to stand before God and say, look at all this great stuff that I've done. I rounded up the heretics and all this kind of stuff. He wanted to stand before God and say, I trust solely on the work of the Lord Jesus. He is my all in all. Verse 10, that I may know him, the cry of his heart, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. I've talked about that before. Wouldn't it be great to fully know and experience the amazing power that raised the Lord Jesus from the dead, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings being conformed to his death? Can we leave that part out of it? That's a little bit more uncomfortable, isn't it? Do you want to know the fellowship of the sufferings of the Lord Jesus, who came to his own and his own completely rejected him? Who came to his own and so much did they reject him that they sent him to the cross to die? Do you want to know the fellowship of his sufferings? Do you want to be conformed to his death? And Paul said, absolutely. I want to be like the Lord Jesus in every way. And so anything that would get in the way of that, that's garbage, because he so much wanted to be like the Lord Jesus in every way. And so thinking back to the Spokane thing made me wonder, do I know the Lord's voice? Can I distinguish his voice from all the other chatter in my head? And if Philippians 3 is the call of my heart, what am I willing to do to get a better hearing of the Lord's voice? What am I willing and able to do to know him more? What are the things in my life that I am willing and need to cast aside so that his voice is the voice that I hear? And so that being united with him, knowing him, truly is the central thing in my life. And in case you aren't already, you ought to be asking yourself the same questions. Let's turn to Psalm 73 now. This is a psalm that I've related to for a long time, even before the Spokane thing. And again, we're not going to go through the whole psalm, but look at some of the highlights of it. Psalm of Asaph, and he starts with his conclusion, "Surely God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart." But then he does a journey that points out that there was a good period of his time, or at least some period of his time, when he didn't hold to that conclusion, that surely God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. And I won't read the whole description, but from verse 2 through verse 12, he talks about the wicked, and his observation is they've got it made. They're wealthy, their life is smooth, even in their death it's peaceful. Everything just seems to be going so well for the wicked. And then he says, verse 13, "Surely in vain I have kept my heart pure and washed my hands in innocence, for I have been stricken all day long and chastened every morning." So he looked at the wicked and said, man, they've got it so easy, and here I'm doing so much, trying to follow God, trying to be pure, trying to stay in his ways, and what good does it do me? I'm stricken all day long, chastened every morning, things are not going well for me, so why not just throw in the towel and be like the wicked? That's where he was at. But then he says in verse 15, if I had said, I will speak thus, if verses 13 and 14, that being following God is a waste of time, if that was his conclusion, behold, I should have betrayed the generation of your children, because that's not the right conclusion. Verse 1 is the right conclusion. When I pondered to understand this, it was troublesome in my sight. He was wrestling with it. Why is it that the wicked seem to have it so easy and the godly seem to be struggling so much? When I pondered to understand this, it was troublesome in my sight until I came into the sanctuary of God. When he came into God's presence, God shed light on the situation and things became more clear to him. When you're struggling with whatever life throws you, where do you go with that? And Asaph, the author of the psalm, said, I came into the presence of God, and that's when the light bulb came on. Probably didn't say light bulb, they didn't have those back then. And again, I'm not going to read the whole description there, but he talks about that God will, in fact, one day judge the wicked. That maybe now for a season, their life is going smooth and easy, but that time will end, and the Lord will judge. Then in verse 21, and this is the section that I have related to for a long time, he goes back to introspection, thinking about his own life, thinking about his own process through life. When my heart was embittered and I was pierced within, then I was senseless and ignorant. I was like a beast before you. And I don't know how many of you can relate to that. Are there times in your life when you're just struggling on the inside and God seems far away, he's not paying attention? If anything, if he's paying attention, it's to kick me while I'm down. I don't know how many of you have struggled through a season like that. And Asaph admitted that he struggled, at least for a season like that. When my heart was embittered and I was pierced within, I was senseless and ignorant, because I wasn't in the presence of God, I was in my own head. I was like a beast before you. Nevertheless, I am continually with you. That even when we're senseless and ignorant, even when life is horribly oppressing us, and our eyes are not on God, and we don't recognize his voice, and we're the sheep wandering away rather than following our shepherd, even then, I am continually with him. Even in those darkest times. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, because you are with me. And so Asaph, again, as he recognized the horrible struggle that he went through on the inside, ultimately that didn't matter, because nevertheless, I am continually with you. You have taken hold of my right hand. And as I think of that, I think of when I've been escorting a little toddler, whether it was one of my own children or grandchildren or some other toddler that I'm escorting, and they're perfectly capable of running, but they're also perfectly capable of running out in the front of busy parking lots or roads or whatever. So when it's time to cross the road or go through the parking lot, I reach down and take them by the hand. And our youngest daughter, when she was just learning to toddle, she used to like to grab on your finger so she could balance and then toddle around. When I'm escorting a toddler where I need to keep track of them, I don't let them just grab me by the finger. I grab hold of their hand in such a way that if they go, ooh, butterflies, let's go that way, it does not matter because I have taken them by the hand and I will lead them where we need to go. And Asaph says, again, even when I was a beast before you, I am continually with you. My struggle doesn't move me away from God. He is still with me, and I am still in his presence. And he takes me by the right hand to lead me where I need to go. With your counsel, you will guide me, and afterward, receive me to glory. What an amen day that will be. That the wicked were not going to be received into glory. He said that in the verses that I just summarized. But even when I'm a beast before him, I'm continually with him. Even in those dark times, he's got me by the hand. Even in those dark times, his counsel still comes to guide me and lead me where I need to go. And at the end, he will receive me into his very presence. That is my hope. And it does not depend on me, because I'm not depending on the righteousness that comes in the flesh that Paul talked about. I'm depending on him holding on to my hand. I'm depending on the work that John talked about last Sunday, the work on the cross and the resurrection. That's our standing before God. And then he echoes some of the thoughts that Paul had in Philippians 3, or maybe Paul was echoing these because these came first. Whom have I in heaven but you? And besides you, I desire nothing on earth. All the other stuff, including the people, are of no account. Besides you, there is nothing on this earth that I desire, is the heart of Asaph. My flesh and my heart, they may in fact fail. And I don't know about yours, but mine do. I get weary, I get worn out. The pressures and all the stuff coming at me. And there are certainly times when my flesh and my heart fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. That even when I'm weak, he's not weak, and he's the one who has me by the right hand. And so even when my flesh and my heart fail, it does not matter because God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. And then in verse 28, the last verse of the psalm there. But as for me, the nearness of God is my good. Paul said, I count everything as garbage compared with knowing Christ. And here Asaph says, for me, the nearness of God, that closeness of relationship with God, that is my God, my good. I have made the Lord God my refuge. That when life is oppressing me, rather than my jumping into the fray and whatever, I can jump behind the Lord God as my refuge, the one who insulates me from all of that, because he will care for me. I have made the Lord God my refuge, a deliberate act, a choice of his mind to say, the Lord God is my refuge, therefore I will not fear. And I do this that I may tell of all your works. What are the works of God that you know about? What are the works of God that you have seen in your life? What are the works of God that you've seen in others' lives? Even in the times when life feels oppressive, when you come out of that, can you look back and say, you know, turns out God was with me the whole way through? Asaph said, I'm making the Lord God my refuge so that I may tell of all your works. When we sing together, to me, that's a big part of what we ought to be doing, proclaiming God's works and through song in ways that maybe we can't do without singing. We ought to tell our friends, our neighbors, or everybody the great things that God has done for us. And what could be a greater thing that God has done for us than to invite us and call us to know him? The eternal God of the universe has called us to know him. Is that so important to me that I'm willing to get rid of everything else that I might know him? Let's pray. Lord, what an amazing thing that you have called us to know you. What a privilege we have to know the eternal God of the universe. May we be faithful to you. May we put you first above everything. And as we do that, and as you change our lives to be more and more like you, even if it means being conformed to your death, may we tell others about the glory of who you are and what you've done. Amen.